tell somebody right now what you came up for prayer for. Just turn to the side and find somebody there standing beside you. Tell them what it is that you're asking the Father to do for you this morning or for someone else. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for your presence this morning. I believe you're great. I believe that you're a good father. And I believe that you have gifts for your children. I don't believe you withhold any good thing from us, Father. And I thank you, Lord God, that healing is our bread. It's our inheritance. Today, Father, we just simply access what was already paid for and provided on the cross. We just speak healing right now over those that came forward this morning, those that could not come forward, and those that are not here, that they're here on behalf of. I just release healing to flow right now. Right now, our body comes together and declares healing, wholeness, health, and strength. And Father, I know Robin is not here, but we're praying for her sister. Right now, we're speaking life and health and strength over Darlene in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We're just praying healing right now in her body. And we speak to her organs right now to come back to life, to receive the life of Christ, the touch from God right now from head to toe. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We praise you. Now just go ahead and sing one more time how great is our God. Those of you who came up for prayer, tell him you're great. Worship him. Individual services. So, you know, that's pretty important to do that. I could cancel speakers altogether, but that really, you know, the DNA of our house, of who we are, is such that we need outside voices coming in. I want to hear what the Father is saying from multiple ministries and persons, and hear what they have to say, hear what they're hearing. So it's pretty key, but we basically canceled the conferences this year. They said he also suggested don't go on multiple mission trips this year, and especially not out of the church. Don't fundraise or fund drive or receive offerings out of the church to go overseas. He said, I know that's in your heart and that's going to be difficult for you, and it is. But he said, if you go on any trips, then raise the money yourself, or go where they're willing to pay you to come.
Yeah.
And so those doors aren't being knocked down just yet. Most of the time people are wanting me to pay to get there and preach and then help them while I'm there too. And so that's fine. There's a place for that and there's a need for that. But we have to get to that point before we can effectively continue to do that. And then, you know, then there were some other suggestions about itinerating. Pastor Terry said, I think you should start establishing a network in the state of Oklahoma. Itinerate yourself out, not on a lot of Sunday mornings, but a few here and there, but mainly on Wednesday nights and Sunday nights or weeknights. And he said, what you'll do is just kind of, if you'll go out and preach, you can take all the offerings and put them into the building program and go out. Pastors will be more likely to open the doors, he said, if they're not just doing it to help build your ministry, but if they're doing it to help build an apostolic center. Yeah. And so, and that has been the case. So I began that 2 weeks ago. I started sending those letters out. I've already met with three pastors now, so those dates are beginning to come in. It's a little slow. Pastors are not the quickest to respond to emails and phone calls and texts. And then they also, you know, they look and they eye you suspiciously for a little bit too. And so you kind of have to stay after them, you know. But anyway, that's another part of the plan. And then a third part of it is an envelope campaign that we want to talk to you about this morning. And it's a brilliant idea. It's a way that everyone can get involved. Because when you start talking about 20,000 even, 50,000, 270,000, a lot of people are on incomes where that is a little intimidating to you. But if we talk to you in a manner that you can get your mind wrapped around it and see there is a way I can contribute to this and be a part of this if we all do it together. What Pastor Terry told me about was you know, you can take envelopes. You can, depending on how, what amount of money you're wanting to raise, you can start at $1 and go up to $100, or you can start at $100 and go to $200 or $150. But if you take $100 and go to $200, which is what we did. Now, we don't have 100 people in our church, so we're going to need a few people to take more than one envelope or pay it off and come back and get a second one. But what we're going to do is two envelope campaigns, one in this next 3 months and then one in the three-month period after that, because we have 6 months between now and lease when the lease is up on the property and we have to re-sign or purchase. So, and there's still some exciting news. I'll tell you about that in just a second. So these two campaigns, if we launch them today, what we do is we have envelopes right now. So let's go ahead and begin passing out the letters that we have. Everything that I'm talking to you about right now is in this fundraising letter. And then there's also a survey that's attached to it because we've been tweaking ministries and teams and toying with the idea of launching some new services and Bible classes here pretty soon. So what we're wanting to do is factor in all of the get input from the congregation. So Pastor Michael and I were talking about circulating a survey, and that's a good way of just checking the pulse of the church and seeing what all works for everyone and getting feedback from you and factoring that in as best as we can when we begin launching new ministries. It's not, you know, one of the trickiest things for me, one of the hardest parts of my job is to be effective at equipping you and training you and teaching you and not cutting too deep into your life. Because you have a life, yeah. and you have a life outside of church. So your life is not all about church. Now mine is, it pretty much is. You know, now my family and I would go do stuff, but my life is church, and because that's what my job is as well. So I the trick is to not cut too deep into your personal time where I've got you coming out 3 and 4 times a week. How many of you know that defeats the purpose? Eventually people get busy and distracted, and you might mean well, and you might say, oh, let's do 4 nights a week, but in a month, you're not going to be coming to everything.
That's right.
And you know I'm telling you the truth.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to be here, and I will have studied my tail end off, and other people that are going to be involved, and we're not going to be reaching everybody in the church with what we're trying to do. So
Yeah. That's
what this survey does, is it helps us kind of look and see what everybody thinks about everything. But if you take the 100 envelopes, everybody... listen for just a second. As they're, I know they're passing that out, the temptation is to start reading, but I want to explain this to you. We have 100 envelopes numbered 100 through 200. So if we took all of those envelopes and put the amount in it that is on it, like if you take an envelope that says 100, your goal is to put $100 in it and turn it back in. But you have 3 months to do it.
Right.
So you can stick money back every week. Because I know a lot of people, $100 is a big chunk for you. And I understand that. But you have 3 months to do it. You can put back a little bit each week, you know, and work on that. You know, you can put back whatever you're comfortable with. Just do the math. Say if I put back so much a week, then it'll take me this long to put $100 back and turn it in. Then you are helping build the church.
Yeah.
Amen? Everybody is helping that way. And we're not coming and receiving three offerings. I was preaching at a church in Springfield one time. It was the most awkward situation I've ever been in my life. I was a guest preacher. They were in an incredible facility. And so I'm up there preaching, and they came up and received the offering, and they're doing worship. And I saw the ushers counting off in the corner. They slipped a note to the pastor. So after the worship song, the pastor came up and said, we need to receive one more offering, because that offering wasn't enough. And so they passed the offering plates again. And so they kept worshiping. And so I saw them over there counting in the corner. They slipped a note to the pastor. He gets up a third time. And this time he said, now listen. He said, you all agreed with me that we were going to sign this mortgage on this new building. He said, I'm not paying this payment by myself. You will help me pay this payment. We will receive offerings this morning until the payment is made. So he said, I hope that this will be the last time we have to pass the plate. And so they passed it a third time.
Wow.
Now, that is not wisdom.
No.
No. then I had to get up and preach behind that to 150 people who were ticked off at the pastor. And, you know, as you can imagine what the fourth offering was for me at the end of the service, we barely got out of town. But anyway, so they probably figured, ah, he's young and dumb. He just wants to preach anyway. But anyway, we're going to avoid stuff like that. We're going to use wisdom, and we're not going to use pressure, and we're not going to get up here and sell prophecies to people. I mean, that's all stuff that happens, okay? It really is. And we're not going to get up here and make every service about money. I don't want you to think that that's what the agenda or the goal is going to be. But there is an assignment that we want to accomplish, and we can accomplish it together. So that's the bottom line of it. And so, you know, the overall goal, 300,000, but there is our primary stage one goal is 50,000 by the 1st of August. But here's the good news. 2 weeks ago, before we even launched this campaign, an individual approached me who wished to remain anonymous and has already put $20,000 up.
Wow.
And they told us, yeah, amen. That's exciting. So they've agreed to match anyone's donations up to $20,000. So what that means is that every dollar you give, it's matched by this donor. So he has that $20,000 donation sitting there as a match pledge offering. And it's legit, okay? It's not somebody that's going to change their mind. This is the real deal, okay? So that is a done deal. He shook my hand and said, this is a covenant agreement between me and you. So that's a done deal, $20,000. A couple of weeks ago, another $1,000 came in. So, I mean, it's already started coming in, but we're not even launching things until today. So what we want to do is really this first 3 months, we want to try and fill all of those envelopes up and get them turned back in. Okay? And so we have the envelopes laid out. Are they on the table?
Yeah.
Numbered 100 through 200. So you just pray about it. The letter says, we want you to pray. We want you to be led by the Spirit. We want you to do what you can do. But listen, there are some of you that can't even afford 100. I'm not trying to exclude you, and I don't want you to feel any guilt or condemnation, okay? Because every dollar you put in helps get this done, okay? So there are envelopes back there that don't have amounts on them. So you can just put whatever amount you want in that envelope. Whenever we see those in the offering plate, we know those are building fund, okay? So whenever you put whatever you want in an envelope. And I'll say that to the other side. There are those sitting here who $200 is not really stretching your faith to give.
Right.
So you might want to put $500 or $1,000 in, and there you can use that unmarked envelope. Or you can take 5 of the other ones, whatever you want to do. But I want to include everyone. I want to involve everyone, and I don't want anyone to feel any pressure or condemnation, okay?
Man.
So this is not the kind of thing where we're going to come up here every week and pull offerings and receive offerings. But here's the thing. We have the potential already we're on track now by the 1st of May to already have that
$20,000. Amen.
And what we can do is go to our owners and go ahead and get the title signed over. Don't even have to wait till August.
Amen.
Then all of our payments will be going towards purchasing our property instead of throwing it out the window on lease.
Amen.
Because that's been frustrating to have to pay rent here for 3 years now. All of that money just gone.
Yeah.
But no more. Okay, that is soon coming to an end. And this is about to be ours. And so that's our goal. And the reason why we've targeted 50 is because 20 is what it'll take to get the title in our name. And then we're going to use that other 30 to get the next project started, which is a building out here. And we may be shooting a little low. We might have to raise. I think more is going to come in than 50 anyway, though.
Yeah.
I really feel pretty strongly about it. I mean, the day after I laid out that 4-point plan, 20,000 came in.
Right.
The day after. We're actually not even officially starting the campaign till this morning. So we're starting it a little slow. I just want to include you in that. Who wants to be my volunteer this morning to fill in some red lines? Because we've already got to bring this thing up. Right now it's sitting down there on 5,000. So I'm going to involve every week. I'm going to get somebody. Let me use Tia this morning.
All right.
And I want to use her for a reason. Tia, over there on that speaker, there's a marker. There's a red marker. And you'll see every one of those big lines represent $5,000. And so we're bringing the thermometer up to the $20,000 mark. You see it there? All right. Nobody's going to criticize your color.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Gia. Yeah, it looks better when you look at a thermometer that you're already starting to climb, right? That's awesome. So read over the letter and then take time to fill out the survey. Because like I said, there are three things on my heart. Getting small groups started back up is on my heart this year. Getting youth ministry started is on my heart really big. Getting how to study the Bible class rolling again, even if it's quarterly. But then getting discipleship classes and leadership classes, those are all on my heart. So what I have to figure out, and you see my dilemma, how do I make that happen in a way that doesn't intrude in your lives too deeply? Because I know that each of those are going to be beneficial to you, but not if I wear you out by dragging you out four times a week. So I'm not going to do that, okay? Everybody understand?
Yes.
Everybody excited?
Yes.
Amen. I am. Brother Solomon?
Hey, Pastor Mark. Yeah. Aren't we going to do some sort of celebration after we hit the goal also?
Mm-hmm. Woo-hoo. Heck yeah. We got to party a little bit. Every goal we hit, we're going to party and celebrate just a little bit. And amen, celebrate hitting the mark. Amanda? Well, please do. That's what I was about to say. And that's a very good point. You can tell employers about this. For example, Stacy was talking about it on the phone with me last week, and when she hung up, her boss hollered from the other room and said, how much money are you needing altogether to buy that property? Well, so, you know, I'm not saying that he's going to give it, but I'm saying, you know, stay tuned to stuff like that. Because there are people that are listening for opportunities to help churches out like that. And so, yeah, please share. And come to me anytime you want any more paperwork printed out, and we'll get some stuff in your hands to pass out to people. Because a lot of times they don't even have to go to our church, you know. But matter of fact, we had a $5,000 offering come in a few months ago online anonymously from someone who does not go to the Grace Center. So that's just how the Lord moves. He speaks to people's hearts and they get in and they support stuff. Jan?
I want to stay focused on the fact that this is not about building a church building.
Yes.
We're building the kingdom of God.
Yes.
If you keep that bigger focus,
yeah,
it will include the community.
Yes. Yes.
Because they'll see the benefits of the kingdom instead of just another church on the corner.
Right.
Very good. Very good point. And that's what Pastor Terry was saying by getting out and getting other pastors involved.
Right.
Matter of fact, let me just tell you, if you were here at the encounter, you probably heard this already, but one of the pastors got the letter from me. And he called me immediately and he said, I'm going to have you out to preach. We're going to receive an offering. We're going to sow into your building program.
Wow.
But he said, I'm more excited about the letter than I am that.
Yes.
And he said, when I read the letter, I heard you speaking my language.
Wow.
And I realized there's someone from my tribe over in Shawnee.
Woo!
He lives in Brotherford. And he said, I want to connect with you. I want our ministries to connect. So they're out there. They've been out there for 20 years building an apostolic hub for their region, which their region of Oklahoma, I think, is the Great Plains region in Weatherford. And ours, we've recently found out, is the Frontier region here in Shawnee. But there are there are six or seven regions that make up the state of Oklahoma. When the Lord told me initially, I'm going to send you out there, you're going to partner with a company to build an apostolic center for that region, region just went in one ear out the other. I thought, oh, he must mean for our part of the state. But there literally are six regions, six or seven, that make up Oklahoma. So so anyway, I began to put two and two together, and this guy wants to meet us. He wants to show us what they've accomplished. They've got this church now is established in such a way that there are churches that are about, the furthest one is an hour away. Most of them are 45 minutes in every direction, that all come in and convene at his church. And his church is like a hub where there are spokes going out into the other churches, and he encourages the pastors and they host conferences. So it's not going to take us 20 years, though. It's just not. There's no way possible. It's going to happen much faster. It's already started happening. Just the capacity that we operate with for a church our size is mind-blowing. I have pastor friends who ask me behind the scenes privately, how do you do the things you do with a church that little? We just don't understand it. You know, now part of the, it's God. It is God. And then part of the reason is that we've been in a building cheap. We pay less than just a little less than $2,000 a month for this building and this property as well. But a lot of my pastor friends are paying $3,000 to $5,000 a month for the facilities that they're in. So that makes a big difference, you know. And we could have done that. We could have jumped into something bigger, but we would have tied our hands, and I don't want to tie our hands. I love just being able to be us and do what we do. Amen? All right, let's go to Ephesians chapter 4. I'm going to read it to you out of the Amplified, or out of the Message Bible. Sorry, out of the Message. Were there any more questions? I'll take time to answer them. I'm going to do something that I don't usually do. I'm going to share some of the stuff this morning that I shared Wednesday night again, so that I can finish it, articulate it a little better. And I made a mistake on Wednesday night that I got to correct this morning as well. So we'll show you what that is in a minute. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Keep in mind, this is the Message Bible, so it's not going to look like what you may be holding in your hand right now. But that's okay. In light of all this, here's what I want you to do. While I'm locked up here, prisoner for the master, I want you to get out there and walk, better yet, run on the road God called you to travel. I want you to understand that the Apostle Paul wasn't talking metaphorically. He was locked up, okay?
Yeah.
He was in prison. There are a section of the New Testament epistles that are called the prison epistles because he was literally in chains and shackles when he wrote them. Man. To the churches, and Ephesians is one of them. I don't want any of you sitting around on your hands. I don't want anyone strolling off down some path that goes nowhere. And mark that you do this with humility and discipline, not in fits and starts, but steadily, pouring yourselves out for each other in acts of love, alert at noticing differences, and quick at mending fences. Can I just repeat those three?
Yeah.
Pour yourselves out for each other in love. Be alert at noticing differences, but quick at mending fences.
Yes.
Okay? You were all called to travel on the same road and in the same direction, so stay together, both outwardly and inwardly. You have one master, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who rules over all, works through all, and is present in all. Man. Everything you are and think and do is permeated with oneness. Everything you are and think and do is permeated with oneness. But that doesn't mean you should all look and speak and act the same. Out of the generosity of Christ, each one of us is given his own gift. The text for this is from the book of Psalms that he's quoting here. He climbed the high mountain, he captured the enemy and seized the booty. There's some pirate talk for you. He handed it all out in gifts to the people. Is it not true that the one who climbed up also climbed down to the valley of the earth, and the one who climbed down is the one who climbed back up to highest heaven? He handed out gifts above and below, filled heaven with his gifts, filled earth with his gifts. He handed out gifts of apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, to train Christ's followers in skilled servant work, working within Christ's body, the church, until we're all moving rhythmically. I like that.
Yeah.
Moving with rhythm and easily with each other, efficient and graceful in response to God's Son, fully mature adults, fully developed within and without, fully alive like Christ. Now I'm going to stop there. I could read the whole chapter, but for sake of time, I don't want to. But I like the Message Bible's rendering of those last few verses there, those last few lines, because we were talking on Wednesday night about all the different denominations out there and the different beliefs. I'll discuss that for a little bit this morning. And even within a church, sometimes there are differences of opinions, but there are always diversities of activities and operations. Your gift may be different than my gift. When Andrew teaches, he doesn't teach anything like me. Why should he? He's Andrew. I'm Mark, right? He has to be him. I have to be me. Solomon has to be Solomon. Everyone has to just be themselves and operate in the gift that they've been graced by God with. Amen?
Amen.
That's why it's important to have a full range of the gifts. Coming into a place, especially a place that calls itself an apostolic hub, because we're trying to equip everyone by exposing you to all of the ministries that we feel are cutting edge, kingdom minded, new covenant founded ministries.
Amen.
Okay,
amen.
To fully equip you and empower you. And I like what he says, that so we could move rhythmically and easily with each other, efficient and graceful. That's a good description for the body of Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Efficient and graceful in response to God's Son, fully mature adults, fully developed within and without, fully alive like Christ. I had a conversation with an atheist years ago. And I want to paint two pictures for you for a few minutes, and then we'll dive into this. I want to use two examples of people that sometimes in the church we see as enemies. Okay? I mean, in the church world, especially in this church and in Undignified, we see people that have various addictions and bondages and things like that. We know they're not the enemy. We know they need deliverance.
Man.
But then there are groups out there in the world who could be classified, if we're not careful, as enemies. For instance, the atheist movement has an agenda that is anti-God. And I'm going to tell you about a conversation I had with an atheist one time, and I'm going to tell you about a conversation I had with a witch, who definitely has a different agenda, okay? But when I had this conversation with this atheist, we worked together for a few years. We developed a friendship. He had a reputation of cussing every Christian out who tried to invite him to church. Anyone who tried to share their faith, he would curse them out. He would ridicule them and shame them and try to challenge them in debate, in philosophical debate, and they lost every time. Nobody could stand their ground with him because he was a brilliant guy. And so I had heard all of this stuff, but he ended up being paired with me for a little while. So we worked together on the same truck for a while, and for about a year. 6 months went by, and he, at lunch one day, he said, "Can I ask you a question?" And I said, "Sure." And he said, "Why have you never invited me to church?" And and I said, "Would you like to come?" And he said, "No, not at all." But he said, "I'm finding it puzzling that you've never invited me." He said, "All the other Christians have." And he said, "And I hear you listening to K-Love and to Air One and different Christian radio stations." And he said, I have to tell you, that's really fascinating to me because that's not the Christian music I grew up listening to." Well, immediately my mind caught the fact that he grew up Christian.
Yeah. Wow.
And so he said, "We only were allowed to listen to pipe organ music."
Oh, wow.
And things like that when we were growing up. Anything that had rhythm like that was not of God. And I said, "Oh, yeah, that's interesting." I said, "Well, times have changed, man." And, you know, and I said, "We know better now. And we're not interpreting the text that way anymore. We've grown, we've matured." So I said, "Forgive us for our ignorance back then." Well, he liked that. So a friendship began to form. We became good friends, and we worked well together. We got a lot of work done when we worked together. And so we were going out of town one day. We had a two-hour drive. We had just pulled out of Edmond, and he looked at me, and he said, "I have a question for you." And he said, "If you can answer this question in a way that satisfies my understanding, then I'll talk to you about God, and I'll tell you why I'm not interested in him anymore." And I said, "Okay, what's your question?" His question were, "Why are there so many different denominations in the world today if you claim to have one God?"
Wow, good question.
And that was something that had been puzzling him, vexing him. So I looked at him and I said, "I'm glad we got 2 hours to drive, because that question is not one that can be answered just over breakfast in a few minutes." So for the next 2 hours, I began to talk with him about revelation that comes from heaven and how different people begin to form around what they agree on. They begin to form groups and circles. You can call them cliques or clubs or whatever you want to call them. They eventually become denominations.
Right.
But then as new denominations come, as new revelation comes rather, you've heard me say before that the people who fight new revelation the hardest is usually the ones who got the last new revelation.
Yeah.
Because they want to still hang on to that and not move into anything new because they see it as a threat.
Yeah.
So they drive their stakes in the ground. They continue to huddle around what they agree on. But somebody squirts out of that group and comes over here and starts a new one. And they're operating with everything that this one operated with, but they're enhanced because they have a new revelation as well. And I said, now, imagine that happening hundreds and hundreds of times. And each cell continues to splinter off. And he said, wow, that sounds very like a very divided thing. And I said, it sounds like a very diverse thing, if you ask me. I said, my thinking on it is that it's exactly the way the Lord intended for it to happen. Much like he scattered the languages so they wouldn't stay camped out in one spot. But he began to scatter them across the earth because it's always been about going out and taking a message out. And in Jerusalem, the early church, the original church at Jerusalem was scattered by persecution. So you would have thought, looking at church history, that would have been the end of that church. But in fact, it was not the end. It was just the spreading of it all over the place. So when persecution arose, they began to scatter. They weren't able to meet in one place anymore. So I find it interesting that what God does is he sends something there to get them all out of the one place that they were used to meeting. Because the church always has had this mindset that church is all about gathering in rather than going out. Church is about going out, not gathering in.
Right.
We only gather in for seasons, for equipping and teaching and training.
Right.
We gather in temporarily, but we go out frequently and consistently. So it's always been about taking the gospel to the world, to the darkest regions and territories of this world. We don't huddle up here waiting on the return of Christ. We come and we get empowered and equipped and trained and activated, and then we take the message out. And so anytime you huddle for too long, look for something to scatter you, okay? Because it's always been a pattern that happened in Scripture. So I laid this out for him for a couple of hours, and he was satisfied with it. It made sense to him, so he opened up, and I told him, I said, now, you know, perspective plays a role. Because I said, a lot of those people don't think like me. A lot of them think they're different, so I'm not going to have anything to do with them. They're different, so we're going to avoid them. I grew up Pentecostal, so I have the right to talk about the Pentecostals. I earned a badge, okay? I have the T-shirt and everything. But the Pentecostals used to think they were the most spiritual group of the body of Christ.
Amen.
Because they spoke in tongues.
Amen.
And so they would ridicule the Baptists, and they would talk about, oh yeah, all my Baptist friends, they're all fine, but when they want prayer, they call their Pentecostal friends because they know we know how to pray. You know, there's arrogance in that statement, but there also is, it also exposes something. We're diverse by design. He designed us to be diverse as a body so that we could lean on and glean from one another. That's always been the design, that we have some part or piece. They have some part or piece. And someone else does, and someone else does. But when we come together, we have a bigger picture. We have a much more clear picture, and we have more clarity. But it takes the right mindset, though, to be willing to overlook differences and come together. So gathering around what we agreed on resulted in denominations. So now we're beginning to gather around spiritual fathers and mothers. We're beginning to gather around movements of heaven in regions and in territories. And so we're able now, because we understand honor and love and kingdom principles like that, to fellowship with people who are different than us.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So, as a matter of fact, I'll tell you what I told the Wednesday night crowd. See if I get the looks that they gave me. Bishop T.D. Jakes said at a pastor's conference one time, the reason why churches are dying off and not growing anymore is because they only will fellowship with others like them. And he said, fruit can only come when you're willing to fellowship with the opposite sex.
There you go.
So he said, churches have become homosexual. That's powerful. There were 5,000 ministers in the room that night when he said that. And half of them shouted, the other half were jaw was hanging open. I mean, he went even deeper than that. But he basically said, You can get together and have fun with someone like you, but no fruit will ever come from it.
Wow.
Give some thought to that. Read between the lines, okay? And so that's what happens when you only fellowship with those like you. But when you're willing to put fear aside and step out of fellowship with those that are different than you and think a little different than you, you know, you can begin to pull some things in that you see working, and or they can provide to you what they were put in the body to provide. You can provide to them what you were put in the body to provide. Together, those kind of relationships bear fruit. As I began to talk with this guy, he opened up to me and he told me about a very tragic moment in his life when he was a young man in his 20s, and he had a daughter who was on her deathbed and a father who was on his deathbed at the same time. And he was praying for healing for both of them, and he was devout Catholic, and so in his mind at the time, the holiest place he could go was Vatican City. So he flew from South Africa to Vatican City to ascend the steps to be blessed and prayed for by somebody in hopes that God would save his daughter and his father. When he got there, and he left at the spur of the moment and caught a plane and went, and didn't pack anything. When he got there, they turned him away at the top of the steps because he had shorts on.
Oh.
And they said, you cannot approach his holiness in cutoffs.
Oh,
wow.
And so they sent him back out and they said, go buy appropriate attire before you can come up for prayer. They both died before he was able to make it back home to South Africa. I mean, now that's horrible. That is an extremely horrible case of religion at its finest. Okay? I remember preaching in Jamaica one time and had an altar call at the end, and people were getting saved and raising their hands and responding to it, and saw a guy standing outside the door, and he was just weeping. He was back there about as far as that door is from where I'm standing, and he was outside weeping and crying, and I said, young man, and he looked up, and I said, come up here. I want to talk to you. I want to pray with you. And he started in, but then he stopped, and I saw someone talking to him, and I said, young man, come up here. I want to pray with you. And he said, I can't. And I leaned over and asked what was going on, and the usher said, he's wearing a muscle shirt and shorts. He can't come into church dressed like that.
Wow.
So I laid the microphone down and walked out.
Hey.
And I said, y'all can wait on me to go pray for this man, because I'm going to step out there and pray for him. And, you know, I had to be respectful because I was in another pastor's pulpit.
Right.
But I still wanted to demonstrate to that man, if you're not going to be able to come in here, I'm going to come out there, because the Holy Ghost is moving on him. So that was my conversation with an atheist. My conversation with a witch was different. And some of you know this story, but I showed up to do a service call at a house one day when I was plumbing. And got out of the truck, my son and I, and noticed something was off about this house. As we're approaching the front door, there's a pentagram hanging on the door. And I looked on the house on the ground, and there was broken glass all around the perimeter of the house. And so I thought, okay, that's interesting. And I'm thinking a little slow. But pretty soon it dawned on me what was going on. And I thought, this is not Halloween. And so, you know, we rang the doorbell. She opened the door, cussed me out immediately for waking her up. And so I apologized. I said, I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. I said, I was given your address and your phone number, and I was told to be here at this time. She had a remodel job going in her bathroom, and so she let us in. When we go in, I came in, and I see the satanic Bible laying there on her table in the entryway. She had a picture on her living room wall of a tree, and a tree was shaped like a cross, and there was a heart in the tree, and there was a butcher knife stabbed into the heart. There was a real butcher knife. The picture was a picture, but the picture had a real knife stabbed into the heart, and it had blood coming down on the tree. And my son was like, don't leave me in this house. Don't you dare walk in. If you go to the truck, I'm going to the truck too. She had a boa constrictor, or a python. She had an albino python who had red eyes in a large cage sitting on the counter. And just all types of incantation stuff laying around, and spell books. And she showed me back to where the bathroom is, and she said, do not go in either one of these two bedrooms. And I said, okay. And so she said, well, there are dogs in there. She said, I have two wolves, and the two wolves are the guardians of my spirit. Then I have a Rottweiler. He guards my property. So if you go into either one of those two rooms, you're in serious trouble. I said, no problem. Is there any way you can put the dogs outside? You know? And she said, I will. When you go in the bathroom and shut the door, then I'll take them out. So it was an interest. I mean, so we go in there. We start working. We're doing what we got to do, and we're remodeling and everything. And she comes in there, and she's strangely attracted to the. So she keeps coming back talking. Just keeps having conversation. And so pretty soon, my son, she didn't know I was a pastor. I hadn't said anything. I was just trying to follow the flow of things and see where it went. Because if I said I'm a pastor, one of two things is going to happen. She's going to become immediately hostile and aggressive, or, you know, she's going to open up. But I wanted to give it time. So, well, my son just blurts out, oh, my dad's a pastor, you know, and I'm looking at him, you know, like, thanks, Caleb, you know. And so she says, oh, really? Well, she pulls a chair in and sits down, and I'm like, oh, man. And so she starts talking, and she says, I have a question that I want to ask you. And she said, I've asked other Christians this and other pastors, and they can't give me an answer, so I want to hear what you have to say. And she said, if an ideal parenting system is a loving mother and a loving father. Now, I understand this, that there's not a lot of ideal situations in America, okay, or in this world. But she said, if an ideal situation is a loving mother and a loving father raising children, instilling the virtues of both into their children, why is Christianity the only religion in the world that doesn't have a father and a mother pattern in their Godhead? Ooh. And she said, all of the other religions, from Wiccan to the Native American worship and idolatry, all have father and mother, spirit gods. But Christianity only talks about one God, one father. And so she said, I'm really puzzled about, if this is the ideal pattern for how to raise children, why he doesn't think he needs anyone else. And so I'm like, inside, I'm like, Jesus, give me wisdom. Give me wisdom right now. The first thing that came back to me was this. One thing I had stumbled across in studies, and I'm not going to dive deep into this subject today, but I believe God is male and female. Yeah. And I've always believed that, because the term, I believe it's the term El Shaddai, or L-O-M, El Shaddai, literally interprets the breasted one. And he is called the El Shaddai. So he is called the Everlasting Father, but he also identifies himself. Matter of fact, he said, I am that I am. Yeah. So he is whatever. He is whatever, whoever he wants to be, whenever he wants to be, however he wants to be it. Amen? But that term, literally, I had stumbled across it before, that it meant that he was the breasted one. And when you really look at Genesis chapter 1, it'll really blow your mind, because it says that he created Adam in his likeness and in his image, male and female created he them in chapter 1. But then later in the next chapter, it says that he says it's not good for man to be alone. So he puts Adam to sleep and reaches in and pulls Eve out of Adam. He doesn't go back to the earth again, but he pulls Eve out of Adam. Think about that one for a little bit. So anyway, I began to lay all of that out to her, and I said, I believe God is both. And I said, but even in the Old Testament scriptures, we have pictures of Jehovah being married to Israel, Israel being the bride of Jehovah. And I said, in the New Testament, we have Christ in the church. Christ is married to the church. And I said, so I think there's all of these rich pictures of male and female there, of father and mother. And I said, I think that ideally, when we act like the bride of Christ, when the church comes out of this mindset of father only, when we come out of that mindset where we begin to act like we're his bride in the earth, I mean, you know, a bride is equal.
Yeah.
A bride is equal. They share equal everything, equal rights. Amen?
Man.
My wife has rights to my name, to use my name. She can sign whatever she wants to sign in my absence because we're equal. She's not under me or behind me. She is equal.
Yeah.
We are equal. We're side by side. woman was taken from the side of man to stand by the side of man. The church was taken from the side of Christ. On the cross, when they pierced his side, that's a picture of the church coming out. The blood and the water flowing out is the birthing of the church, called to stand by the side of Christ. So we are equals. And I said the ideal pattern is for us to walk with him in such a relationship where we are his equal in this earth, and we are living like the bride of Christ. And I said the church should really, a healthy church should function with mother instincts.
Amen.
And help people understand their father.
Yes.
Now, how many of you had a hard father growing up? Or he maybe got a little hard from time to time? I did. I have a great dad. He's a wonderful dad. We've always been close, but there were times I didn't like him too much. There were times where he opened my door at 5 a.m. and said, "Get up, and here's a list of things I want you to do today." You know, and I'm like, "Oh, man, I do not like this guy." You know, I loved him when we were fishing the week before, but I don't like him this morning. And then all the times he took us out and put shovels in our hands and made us work. And made us, you know, work at a young age. I liked him on Friday when he handed me the check, but I did not like him Monday through Friday. Monday through Friday, we only got 10-minute lunch breaks, and we baked in the summer, and we froze in the winter, and we worked like grown men at the age of 12. But on Friday, when he's given 12-year-old and a 13-year-old, a $250 and $300 check, I loved him. I was like, "Thank you, Jesus, for my daddy." But you know who I went to privately behind the scenes to talk to about my dad? My mom. I would go to her, and I remember conversations where I'd say, "I hate him because of whippings that I had gotten," or something like that. And she would gently, you know, she didn't attack me. You know, when somebody tells us, "I'm atheist, I don't believe in God," we want to attack them immediately. "You're an idiot is what you are." But I just showed you a while ago that the reason why people have those types of beliefs in place, it usually stems back to a lack of understanding or some type of trauma or tragedy where the church has misrepresented God to the world.
Right.
And so that my friend had seen a picture of God that was not accurate. And I had the chance to apologize to him on behalf of those who misrepresented God to him. And I said, "He is a good father. He's a loving father." And I said, "What you saw was religion. There is a pure religion that James talks about, but what you saw wasn't it." And so, you know, I believe I sowed seeds into that man's life. I don't even know where he's at or what he's doing now. But you'll never be able to tell me that something didn't happen in his life where he was actually given a chance to see somebody Christ-like who operated in love. So we want to tell people when they say, I'm atheist or I'm a Satanist, you're an idiot. You know, you're stupid. You don't know what you're talking about. God is going to get you when he comes back. He is going to squash you with a boot under his. And what does that do? That just further instills the knowledge that they have in them that he's someone to be feared. That he's not someone they can have a loving relationship with. And so I sat and visited with her, and I explained all that to her, and her mind was blown. She said, "I've never heard anybody say that before." And she said, "Do you interpret dreams?" And I said, "I have." You know, I said, "I have before. I don't always, but sometimes I can get them." And so she begins to tell me a dream. She said, "I've talked to my Satanist priest about this dream. I've talked to the rabbi. And I went down the street to a Protestant church and I told him the dream. None of the three could answer the dream." And I said, "Well, tell me, shoot." So she told me the dream. Immediately, the Holy Spirit gave me the meaning. Right there on the spot, immediately. I interpreted her dream and I began to prophesy to her and lay some things out there. She started weeping right there in her house. And I said, "I don't know if you've ever walked with God before, but you're about to. He's about to invade your life with his presence. And he's going to reveal himself to you." She began to talk to me about how from a young age she had been able to predict things and see things. And I said, "Well, the thing is you probably had gifts. You probably had gifts in your life, but you were at some point in your life, you were taking a different direction and those gifts became perverted or corrupted. But I said, those gifts, when turned in the right direction, they'll be used for the glory of God's kingdom." And Then she opened up and just blurted it out. She said, my parents were spirit-filled tongue talkers. And she said, I was raised in church. And she said, at the age of 6, they both died in a car wreck.
Oh.
And she said, I had no relatives to go to except an aunt who lived in London. They flew me to London, and my aunt was a witch. And so she said, my aunt raised me in Wiccan and witchcraft, and I never looked back at Christianity moving forward. And she said, as a matter of fact, my aunt also instilled it into me that if God was real, then why did he snatch your parents out of your life? You know, so she planted that seed in a small child's mind and heart at a very young age. And then so that woman began to corrupt the gifts that she had in her. So I said all of that to say this. The conclusion is that there are people hurting in this world. They're hurting for reasons, and sometimes hurt manifests as hate because they don't know any difference. They do not understand how to manifest it any other way. That's to be expected from the world. However, from the church who claims that God is love and for God so loved the world, it comes as quite a shock to the ones who are still in the grip of the world when they see us operate in hate. That doesn't make sense to them. That makes them want to turn away from God, period, because we are supposed to be his body in the earth. We are supposed to be his likeness and his image. If he was the exact representation of his father, and Hebrews 1 says that he was, amen? It says that Hebrews chapter 1 says he was the exact representation of his father. So it says in times gone by, God spoke to us through prophets and other various ways. But in these last days, those last days, he has spoken to us by his son. Amen?
Amen.
You remember the verses I'm talking about now, right? And then he says, who is the exact representation of the Father?
Yeah.
So in the fullness of time, when God was ready to reveal himself to humanity, he sends Jesus.
Amen.
And he says, this is what I look like. This is what I talk like. This is what I act like.
Amen.
I heal people. I love people. I show compassion to the sinner. I forgive sins. I walk around and forgive sins before people even ask.
Yeah.
Oh, Pastor Mark, what are you talking about? You have to confess before he saves you. Well, tell that to the person, the sick person they brought to him to be healed. And he said, son, your sins are forgiven.
Yeah.
The man didn't even ask. He didn't ask for forgiveness of sins, and that wasn't even what he needed. I think he did it to trip out all the religious people that were sitting around, and they all started immediately. The hair stands up on the back of their neck, and they said, who does this man think he is trying to forgive sins? And Jesus said, which is easier to say, that your sins are forgiven or take up your bed and walk? But so you know, I do have power to forgive sins. Take up your bed and walk. And the guy gets up and carries his bed and walks out of there. Amen. So that's the demonstration, though. If he was the Father's exact representation, then the church is to be his exact representation in the earth. Because not only are we corporately his bride, but individually we're sons. Son speaks of a seed, of a DNA. We're born of him. We come from him. We have emerged from him, but we have his qualities. We have his likeness. We have his DNA on the inside of us. Corporately, these terms are all symbolic terms to help us understand our role and our positions. So are we a son or are we a bride? Yes. We're both. Amen. We're both. Corporately, we're the bride. Corporately, we're also a city set on a hill.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Jesus said a city set on a hill cannot be hidden.
That's right.
You can see it from a great distance away, the light that it puts off. So corporate, individually, we are the church. We are members individually of his church and of his body. But it's when there becomes a corporate rhythm between us that we begin to emit the light of a city on a hill. That's what I'm after this morning. I won't even get too far into the notes now because I already found the vein and went a different way. But we are to come together in such a way where unity and love and honor connects us.
Amen.
Where we find connectivity and we begin to function together and accurately represent him in the earth. And when we do so, the world will see Jesus. I got news for you. The next time the world sees Jesus, it's not going to be when he returns and stands in a temple in the Middle East.
That's right.
Okay? Because in the new covenant now, you are the temple. You and I together are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Okay? So what that means for us, what we, it means, it's not really about his return anymore. It's about his appearing. In the new covenant, it's about his appearing. And you see that constantly in the epistles, when he appears, when he appears. It's not talking about when he returns. It's talking about when he appears in his temple or from his temple, okay? So when he appears this time in his new temple, which when we begin to function with corporate anointing is New Jerusalem. It's not Old Jerusalem, which is a geographic location in the Middle East. It's New Jerusalem, which is a spiritual city that comes down out of Zion. Okay, so it's a spiritual city, it's a spiritual company, it's a spiritual a city that's set on a hill emitting a great light, and people are attracted to that light. Yeah. People cannot resist it, just like when you turn your porch light on, moths and bugs begin to come in to your light, you know, because when you turn light on, people will come to it. Now, I'm not calling people insects. I'm just using it as an analogy, okay? But I will prophesy and tell you the people that are bugging you the most are the ones you're called to witness to. Amen. They're the ones that God has placed an anointing in your life to deliver and to encourage and to heal them when they need to be healed in his name. Amen. So we're his body in the earth, and we're designed to manifest his presence here. Amen. So that's what Isaiah saw when Isaiah prophesied and said, in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house would be established on top of all the other hills. And he saw a picture of a new covenant church, a new covenant Zion established on top of all the other hills. And he saw people fled. And then Micah gets a hold of the revelation, and he repeats it again in Micah chapter 4. He sees the same thing, and he says people will flow to it. Yes, and they will say, let us go to Zion that we may hear how to govern our lives. Now, I haven't even read it in years, but I know that it's there. It's something that I've meditated on and I've preached. If somebody wants to look it up, I'll gladly let you read it. But it literally says that people will, when they see Mount Zion established on top of all the other hills, people will flow to it, and they'll say, let's get our government from that place. Let's flow and get everything that we need from that place. Amen. Now, Psalms chapter 133. This is the last text I'll share with you this morning. Psalm 133.
Glory.
I didn't even get to get into the body stuff today. Behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edge of his garments. Let me tell you what that's a picture of, okay? That is a picture of the anointing that flows down onto Christ, who is the head. Amen. The beard, the reason why it says the beard of Aaron is because Aaron represents priesthood, okay? But what it's talking about is the fivefold. In the New Testament, we're all kings and priests. Okay, all of us. So it runs from the head down onto the beard, then down onto the garments. What it's a picture of is that anointing oil flows from the top down. It comes from Christ. But it says how good, how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. What is it like when brethren dwell together in unity? He says, oh, I know what it's like. It's like the oil that is poured upon the head, then runs down onto Aaron's beard, then runs down on the garments. It is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. You know, now oil and dew were both very significant to them in that culture because they both meant something valuable. So he's talking about precious commodities here, which are to us pictures of the anointing and the Spirit of Christ and the Holy Spirit. And he says, for there, where? Where brethren are dwelling together in unity, where anointing is flowing, there the Lord commands the blessing, life forevermore. So the Lord, we want the blessing, but the Lord says, oh, it's easy peasy, man. Come together in unity. When you come together in unity, my anointing is there flowing. My anointing is flowing. So where you're in unity, my anointing is flowing. Where the anointing is flowing, I command blessing. Amen. So there it is right there. That's the reason for unity. You say, well, now that's easy to accomplish in the Grace Center because we love one another most of the times, right? And we're developing friendships and connections. And I know we have misunderstandings. But, just, you know, that's just maturity is just about working through that stuff. And yeah, I'll tell you right now, I've made mistakes in how I've handled things over the last 3 years a few different times. But one thing about me is that I will apologize. Hallelujah. And I will move forward and I won't make the same mistake again. Amen. Amen. But it's kind of like going to the gym, which I've been going back, by the way. And man, it hurts. When you don't go, let's think about the body of Christ for just a second, okay? What happens to you when you decide to eliminate sugar from your diet? You're regularly ingesting sugar in various forms. What's your body going to say about that? It's not going to like it. Somebody tell me, what are some symptoms you're going to have when you remove the sugar from your diet? Headaches. And all the migraines. Your body is going to begin to go through withdrawal symptoms, right? When you eliminate caffeine from your diet. Same thing. Your body is going to start hurting. What? Some of you are like, I don't have a clue, man. I have sugar and caffeine every day. More power to you, man. Be careful that you don't look like me at 46, though. So, but when you start eliminating things that you're regularly ingesting, and all of a sudden you see the need for a change. And a lot of times, we don't make necessary changes until we're on the precipice. Is that not human nature? To wait until a tragedy hits. Do you know what has got my attention right now? I feel fine, but watching my dad go through everything he's gone through has woke me up. And I've decided, I love my dad, but I don't want to put my kids through what I've had to go through watching him hurt and suffer. All correctable years ago. Years ago when it just started off as a single diagnosis of diabetes. And they said, oh, Fred, all you got to do is just maintain this particular diet. Now, I'm not knocking on my dad. I'm just using him because that's how we all are. It all starts as something very controllable, something where just a minor adjustment is needed. But if we don't make the change then later down the road, a crisis happens. A tragedy happens. Sickness comes, a disease comes on, it begins to get out of control. And then on the precipice, we're willing to start making more drastic changes. And sometimes some people won't change until they're literally fighting for their life. And that's a little bit beyond the precipice, you know. That's when, like, I have to do this to survive now. I don't want to wait till that. But, you know, I reckon that. I connect that to the grace message. When all of a sudden there's an adjustment in the intake of what the body of Christ has been receiving, there's a knee-jerk reaction from the rest of the body that says, I don't know what to think about this. This is not what I'm used to eating. This gives me a headache to think about this too hard. I'm not sure that I can handle what you're trying to feed me right now. So the knee-jerk reaction is to reject it or to find it repulsive. But that's just a knee-jerk reaction from a part of the body that's not receiving that at this time. They will in due time, but not until they see the fruit of it, probably. Because there are a lot of people that just want to know that it's really going to produce a changed life. And when a body also is not used to exercising, and all of a sudden you go back to the gym. You know, now I started easy this week. I just started on the bike. I just went in there and played basketball and rode the bike. That's all. And that's all I decided I'm going to do this whole first week. Man, that next day, I was embarrassed at myself at how soft I had gotten, that just playing basketball made me hurt that bad, and riding an exercise bike. But what do? You push through. You have to push through it. You have to push through it because what happens, see, now I'm painting a parallel picture here for you. There are going to be times in this growth process where you're going to hurt too. And you're going to ache as well because under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, I'm leading the body to do something you're not comfortable doing. And maybe even you've never done it before. So upon initially doing it, you're going to become sore with me. And you're going to hurt just a little bit. But I'm just asking you to trust the Father. That's what I'm asking to do. Because I'm only leading in directions that I feel like he's taking me.
Yes.
Now, what I need to learn to do is use a little more wisdom as I make those moves. And I will. I definitely will. But I'm going somewhere with all of that.
Come on.
You know, we're going to be making turns and movements that we've not made before. Things are going to get uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And there are going to be some changes. There are going to be some new things initiated, new teams put in place. All of them. We've really had a leadership team that just is kind of this big team that just comes together and talks as a team. But even that's going to receive definition where there's going to be a finance team. You really don't need all your elders coming together stressing over the bills of the church.
Right.
You need somebody that's anointed for finance.
That's right.
Somebody that's gifted and anointed for finance to handle all of that. That's their thing. That's what they do in life.
Yeah.
And then you need your elders to just be turned loose to teach and to preach and to minister to people and to pray for people. And, you know, so all of that stuff is going to be getting definition and clarity. We're going to launch new classes and stuff. But as we begin to make movements we've not made before, you'll have a little bit of soreness. But what we have to do is we have to be tender and kind-hearted with one another and forgiving with one another, amen,
yeah. Yeah.
And offer grace to one another, and we have to be flexible.
That's right.
One of the things that Heather taught us when we went up to boot camp every day is start your day stretching. Start every morning by stretching. And I learned that. That is a very smart thing to do because you will hurt yourself. You will injure yourself if you don't warm up first. If you don't get the muscles stretched out and warmed up first before you start doing stuff. So I'm excited about what he's doing here. I'm excited about what he's doing globally as well. But what we're doing here, I have a vision for what we're doing here. But I also see what we're doing here fitting into a global picture.
Yeah.
I see it fitting into a regional picture and into a global picture. It is very exciting. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Let's stand up. We'll receive the tithe and offering. Thank you. What I want to say to everyone, though, if you're struggling to find how this message is relevant to you today, like maybe you're just struggling in your life for a better job, or maybe you're believing for a spouse or restoration in a marriage or a friendship or something like that. You know, I mean, maybe you're like, well, you know, I needed this, but I came in and got taught about the body of Christ. What does that have to do with anything? But what I want to tell you is that it has everything to do with it. Because there is an alignment process that when you find your place and you snap into place and find your alignment, the flow begins to happen in your life. And we'll get into that the next time that I preach, which is going to be a couple of weeks. But we'll talk about the body of Christ and adjustments and alignments and all of the different functions of organs and bones and tendons and ligaments and all of that. But the key thing is isolation is not a good thing. And if you're cut off from the body, the flow of life can't make its way to you. And, you know, so you're all about, you're trying to resuscitate something that if you were just connected a little more tightly, then the flow would be there. And we could help maintain you. We could help encourage you and support you, minister to you, you know, do whatever we could do financially whenever we can. We can't do a lot at this time. We're not a big church. But at least if you're connected, you know, there's something, we can maintain that connection. We can maintain a relationship. We can maintain a back and forth reciprocation of life. That's very much what a body does. There is a flow of life throughout your body, carried to every extremity of your body. One of the most interesting things I brought out on Wednesday night was that a bone from your body, when that bone is out of the body, it becomes brittle and dry and eventually dies. But when it is inside the body, every bone is alive. It's alive, and there is a life flow of there's a network of veins and tissue and nerves running through the bones of your body. And your bones are even a vital process of supplying nutrients to your blood as well. So it's an amazing thing. I think it's awesome that the Apostle Paul takes that picture and says, let me talk to you about the body of Christ. And he begins to talk about all the many members of your body to compare to the body of Christ. So here's how that applies to you. when you're the deeper and stronger your connection is, the greater the flow of life from us into you.
Yeah, good.
That matters. That matters. It really does, because it's you. You draw encouragement. You draw strength. You draw words of wisdom, words of knowledge, prophecies. You get teaching in your life. When you're exposed to teaching on a regular basis, it causes things in you that were dormant to flare back up again. Amen. They begin to fire back up, much like a flame that has gone out. And all of a sudden, when the wind hits it just right, it stokes and it fires back up again. Those are all the reasons why this message was for every one of us. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we love you. We thank you for your word this morning. I thank you for every person here, and I thank you for the opportunity that we're embarking on to raise this money this year. And Lord, I know you can send one person by and write a check for all of it, but I appreciate opportunities to partner with you in what you're doing. And I think that you're challenging us to step out and partner with you in the area of our finance, because we will find what many others have found before, that we cannot outgive you. No matter how hard we try, every time we begin to give, Father God, that generosity of heaven is turned back towards us again, because you love a cheerful giver.
Amen.
And you are able to make all sufficiency, all of your grace abound towards us, so that we would have a sufficiency for every good need that comes along our way. You don't want to just bless us so we can hang out in the Caribbean the rest of our life.
Right.
I mean, that's fun to go visit. But you want to bless us to be a blessing. You want to raise us up and establish us financially to meet kingdom needs. And we're grateful for that, Father. I thank you. You're going to do the miraculous through Grace Center this year.
Yes.
Together we can make this happen.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yes, ma'am. Amen. I agree. Okay, so we are going to receive tithe and offering on the way out. You can bring that up and sow that. And if you're watching on live stream, you can go to gracecenter.tv and donate there. We welcome you this morning as well. Then on your way out, if you want to go ahead and grab an envelope and you already know what amount you want to start with, feel free to grab one. But you can pray about that over the next few services and take one and just call if you have any questions about it, okay? All right, we love you. I love you. We're not going to see you for a couple of weeks. We're going to be leaving Wednesday morning, and we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen? All right, God bless you. Well, insects. I'm just using it as an analogy, okay? But I will prophesy and tell you, the people that are bugging you the most are the ones you're called to witness to. Amen? They're the ones that God has placed an anointing in your life to deliver and to encourage and to heal them when they need to be healed. In his name, amen? So we're his body in the earth, and we're designed to manifest his presence here. Amen? So that's what Isaiah saw when Isaiah prophesied and said, in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house would be established on top of all the other hills.
Yeah,
and he saw a picture of a new covenant church, a new covenant Zion established on top of all the other hills. And he saw people and then Micah gets a hold of the revelation and he repeats it again in Micah chapter 4. He sees the same thing and he says, people will flow to it.
Yes,
and they will say, let us go to Zion that we may hear how to govern our lives. Now, I haven't even read it in years, but I know that it's there. It's something that I've meditated on and I've preached. If somebody wants to look it up, I'll gladly let you read it. But it literally says that people will, when they see Mount Zion established on top of all the other hills, people will flow to it, and they'll say, let's get our government from that place. Let's flow and get everything that we need from that place. Amen. Now, Psalms chapter 133. This is the last text I'll share with you this morning. Psalm 133.
Glory.
I didn't even get to get into the body stuff today. Behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head running down on the beard of Aaron.
Yes.
Running down on the edge of his garments. Let me tell you what that's a picture of, okay? That is a picture of the anointing that flows down onto Christ, who is the head.
Amen.
The beard, the reason why it says the beard of Aaron is because Aaron represents priesthood, okay?
Yes.
But what it's talking about is the fivefold. In the New Testament, we're all kings and priests.
Yes, sir.
Okay, all of us. So it runs from the head down onto the beard, then down onto the garments. What it's a picture of is that anointing oil flows from the top down. It comes from Christ. But it says how good, how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. What is it like when brethren dwell together in unity? He says, oh, I know what it's like. It's like the oil that is poured upon the head, then runs down onto Aaron's beard, then runs down on the garments. It is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. You know, now oil and dew were both very significant to them in that culture, because they both meant something valuable. So he's talking about precious commodities here, which are to us pictures of the anointing and the Spirit of Christ and the Holy Spirit. And he says, for there, where brethren are dwelling together in unity, where anointing is flowing, there the Lord commands the blessing, life forevermore. So the Lord, we want the blessing, but the Lord says, oh, it's easy peasy, man. Come together in unity. When you come together in unity, my anointing is there flowing. My anointing is flowing. So where you're in unity, my anointing is flowing. Where the anointing is flowing, I command blessing. Amen. So there it is right there. That's the reason for unity. You say, well, now that's easy to accomplish in the Grace Center because we love one another most of the times, right? And we're developing friendships and connections. And I know we have misunderstandings, but just, you know, that's just maturity is just about working through that stuff.
That's right.
And I'll tell you right now, I've made mistakes in how I've handled things over the last 3 years a few different times. But one thing about me is that I will apologize.
Hallelujah.
And I will move forward and I won't make the same mistake again.
Amen.
Amen. But it's kind of like going to the gym, which I've been going back, by the way. And man, it hurts. When you don't go, let's think about the body of Christ for just a second, okay? What happens to you when you decide to eliminate sugar from your diet? You're regularly ingesting sugar in various forms. What's your body going to say about that? It's not going to like it. Somebody tell me, what are some symptoms you're going to have when you remove the sugar from your diet? Headaches. In all the migraines, your body is going to begin to go through withdrawal symptoms, right? When you eliminate caffeine from your diet, same thing. Your body is going to start hurting. What? Some of you are like, I don't have a clue, man. I have sugar and caffeine every day. More power to you, man. Be careful that you don't look like me at 46, though. So, but when you start eliminating things that you're regularly ingesting, and all of a sudden you see the need for a change. And a lot of times, we don't make necessary changes until we're on the precipice. Is that not human nature? To wait until a tragedy hits. Do you know what has got my attention right now? I feel fine, but watching my dad go through everything he's gone through has woke me up. And I've decided, I love my dad, but I don't want to put my kids through what I've had to go through watching him hurt and suffer. All correctable years ago. Years ago, when it just started off as a single diagnosis of diabetes, and they said, oh, Fred, all you got to do is just maintain this particular diet. Now, I'm not knocking on my dad. I'm just using him because that's how we all are. It all starts as something very controllable, something where just a minor adjustment is needed. But if we don't make the change then later down the road, a crisis happens. A tragedy happens. Sickness comes, a disease comes on, it begins to get out of control. And then on the precipice, we're willing to start making more drastic changes. And sometimes some people won't change until they're literally fighting for their life. And that's a little bit beyond the precipice, you know. That's when, like, I have to do this to survive now. I don't want to wait till that. But, you know, I reckon that. I connect that to the grace message. When all of a sudden there's an adjustment in the intake of what the body of Christ has been receiving, there is a knee-jerk reaction from the rest of the body that says, I don't know what to think about this. This is not what I'm used to eating. This gives me a headache to think about this too hard. I'm not sure that I can handle what you're trying to feed me right now. So the knee-jerk reaction is to reject it or to find it repulsive. But that's just a knee-jerk reaction from a part of the body that's not receiving that at this time. They will in due time, but not until they see the fruit of it, probably. Because there are a lot of people that just want to know that it's really going to produce a changed life. And when a body also is not used to exercising, and all of a sudden you go back to the gym, you know, now I started easy this week. I just started on the bike. I just went in there and played basketball and rode the bike. That's all. And that's all I decided I'm going to do this whole first week. Man, that next day, I was embarrassed at myself at how soft I had gotten, that just playing basketball made me hurt that bad, and riding an exercise bike. But what do? You push through. You have to push through it. You have to push through it, because what happens, see, now I'm painting a parallel picture here for you. There are going to be times in this growth process where you're going to hurt too. And you're going to ache as well, because under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, I'm leading the body to do something you're not comfortable doing. And maybe even you've never done it before. So upon initially doing it, you're going to become sore with me. And you're going to hurt just a little bit. But I'm just asking you to trust the Father. That's what I'm asking you to do. Because I'm only leading in directions that I feel like He's taking me. Now, what I need to learn to do is use a little more wisdom as I make those moves. And I will. I definitely will. But I'm going somewhere with all of that.
Come on.
You know, we're going to be making turns and movements that we've not made before. Things are going to get uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And there are going to be some changes. There are going to be some new things initiated, new teams put in place. All of them. We've really had a leadership team that just is kind of this big team that just comes together and talks as a team. But even that's going to receive definition, where there's going to be a finance team. You really don't need all your elders coming together stressing over the bills of the church.
Right.
You need somebody that's anointed for finance.
Amen.
Somebody that's gifted and anointed for finance to handle all of that. That's their thing. That's what they do in life.
Yeah.
And then you need your elders to just be turned loose to teach and to preach and to minister to people and to pray for people. And, you know, so all of that stuff is going to be getting definition and clarity. We're going to launch new classes and stuff. But as we begin to make movements we've not made before, you'll have a little bit of soreness. But what we have to do is we have to be tender and kind-hearted with one another and forgiving with one another. Amen.
Yeah. Yeah.
And offer grace to one another. And we have to be flexible.
That's right.
One of the things that Heather taught us when we went up to boot camp every day is start your day stretching. Start every morning by stretching. And I learned that. That is a very smart thing to do, because you will hurt yourself. You will injure yourself if you don't warm up first. If you don't get the muscles stretched out and warmed up first before you start doing stuff. So I'm excited about what He's doing here. I'm excited about what He's doing globally as well. But what we're doing here, I have a vision for what we're doing here. But I also see what we're doing here fitting into a global picture.
Yeah.
I see it fitting into a regional picture and into a global picture. It is very exciting. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Let's stand up. We'll receive the tithe and offering. Thank you. What I want to say to everyone, though, if you're struggling to find how this message is relevant to you today, like maybe you're just struggling in your life for a better job, or maybe you're believing for a spouse or restoration in a marriage or a friendship or something like that. You know, I mean, maybe you're like, well, you know, I needed this, but I came in and got taught about the body of Christ. What does that have to do with anything? But what I want to tell you is that it has everything to do with it, because there is an alignment process that when you find your place and you snap into place and find your alignment, the flow begins to happen in your life. And we'll get into that the next time that I preach, which is going to be a couple of weeks. But we'll talk about the body of Christ and adjustments and alignments and all of the different functions of organs and bones and tendons and ligaments and all of that. But the key thing is isolation is not a good thing. And if you're cut off from the body, the flow of life can't make its way to you. And, you know, so you're all about, you're trying to resuscitate something that if you were just connected a little more tightly, then the flow would be there. And we could help maintain you. We could help encourage you and support you, minister to you, you know, do whatever we could do financially whenever we can. We can't do a lot at this time. We're not a big church. But at least if you're connected, you know, there's something, we can maintain that connection. We can maintain a relationship. We can maintain a back and forth reciprocation of life. That's very much what a body does. There is a flow of life throughout your body, carried to every extremity of your body. One of the most interesting things I brought out on Wednesday night was that a bone from your body, when that bone is out of the body, it becomes brittle and dry and eventually dies. But when it is inside the body, every bone is alive. It's alive, and there is a life flow of, there's a network of veins and tissue and nerves running through the bones of your body. And your bones are even a vital process of supplying nutrients to your blood as well. So it's an amazing thing. I think it's awesome that the Apostle Paul takes that picture and says, let me talk to you about the body of Christ. And he begins to talk about all the many members of your body to compare the body of Christ. So here's how that applies to you. When you're the deeper and stronger your connection is, the greater the flow of life from us into you. That matters. That matters. It really does, because it's you. You draw encouragement. You draw strength. You draw words of wisdom, words of knowledge, prophecies. You get teaching in your life. When you're exposed to teaching on a regular basis, it causes things in you that were dormant to flare back up again. They begin to fire back up, much like a flame that has gone out. And all of a sudden, when the wind hits it just right, it stokes and it fires back up again. Those are all the reasons why this message was for every one of us. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we love you. We thank you for your word this morning. I thank you for every person here. And I thank you for the opportunity that we're embarking on to raise this money this year. And Lord, I know you can send one person by and write a check for all of it. But I appreciate opportunities to partner with you in what you're doing. And I think that you're challenging us to step out and partner with you in the area of our finance, because we will find what many others have found before, that we cannot outgive you, no matter how hard we try. Every time we begin to give, Father God, that generosity of heaven is turned back towards us again, because you love a cheerful giver. And you are able to make all sufficiency, all of your grace abound towards us, so that we would have a sufficiency for every good need that comes along our way. You don't want to just bless us so we can hang out in the Caribbean the rest of our life. I mean, that's fun to go visit, but you want to bless us to be a blessing. You want to raise us up and establish us financially to meet kingdom needs. And we're grateful for that, Father. I thank you. You're going to do the miraculous through Grace Center this year.
Yes.
Together, we can make this happen.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Yes, ma'am.
When I was praying about someone to finance our building, I was asking for a millionaire or a billionaire or something. And God just spoke to me real plainly. That's not the way I want it done.
Amen. I agree. Okay, so we are going to receive tithe and offering on the way out. You can bring that up and sow that. And if you're watching online on live stream, you can go to gracecenter.tv and donate there. We welcome you this morning as well. And then on your way out, if you want to go ahead and grab an envelope and you already know what amount you want to start with, feel free to grab one. But you can pray about that over the next few services and take one and just call if you have any questions about it, okay? All right, we love you. I love you. We're not going to see you for a couple of weeks. We're going to be leaving Wednesday morning, and we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen? All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, and the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you. And we'll be back, though, on the 19th. Amen. All right, God bless you.